on trial. Okay, Jesus was on trial 2,000 years ago, and now it's our turn to go on trial. And last week, we went on trial, right? We went on trial. You know, the only thing that we need to wrestle with and be honest is that we need to apply the Word of God to us. Okay? Because sometimes we're just thinking about somebody else. You know, I mentioned it last week. And we think about somebody else, that somebody else is doing that and not us. Because, you see, the application was taking in consideration the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the religious people, that they were jealous of Jesus and they were self-righteous, right? So the application was for us. If I'm jealous and self-righteous in my treatment, in my dealings with other people, okay, we need to consider that about myself. Because you see, when we are jealous, self-righteous, then the way we treat other people is unjustly. Because that's exactly what happened with Jesus. He was being treated unjustly. Why? Because of that. Jealousy and self-righteousness. So when we fall into that, that's what we are going to be doing also in our dealings with other people. All right? So, and something that we have to take in consideration, okay? I want you to think about this. Who condemned and crucified Jesus? Okay? Well, you see, we can start arguing and considering that the Romans, the Jews, and God and this, but in reality, you know, we can blame it on everybody, but at the same time, we have to be honest, and it was the church in Jesus' day. The church, it was the religious leaders of Israel. It was Israel. The first sermon that Peter preached after Pentecost, he told them, the Jews, you crucify the Christ. You crucify the Christ. So that's why it's applicable to us to consider about being like a Pharisee, being self-righteous. Because we are the ones that we are most likely to behave in that manner, us. Not the world, but us. We are most likely to behave in a self-righteous way. So that's why we have to be very honest and meditate and see if I have that tendency to be jealous, to be self-righteous. We have to be very honest, okay? So now we're going to continue. So open your Bibles, Luke chapter 23. And now we're going to read from verses 5 through 12. 5 through 12 in Luke. All right. Luke 23, verse 5. Got it? All right. It reads like this. But they insisted. He stirs up the people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here. On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased because for a long time he had been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform a sign of some sort. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed him and mocked him, dressing him in elegant robe. They sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies. So now, as you can see, this part, the trial of Jesus continues to be a mockery of, you know, really following law. Jews, the Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court, they were not following the laws in the trial of Jesus. The Romans were not following the law. Okay? Even though they knew, Pilate and Herod, there was nothing wrong with this man. To be condemned, there was nothing. But they were afraid of people, they were politically correct, and they were afraid for their position, their power, their money, and all that. So nobody was doing the right thing in that court. Okay? Nobody was doing that. And we can tell here, even the enemies were becoming friends in that unjust process. So now, I want you to focus in one thing about Herod, okay? Because last week we used for application the religious leaders, the Pharisees, for us to be careful not to become like a Pharisee and behave like a Pharisee, okay? So now we're going to look at Herod, and we're going to use this verse here where it says, Herod was delighted at the opportunity to see, okay, this Herod is the one that decapitated John the Baptist. Okay? He is the one. Now he was delighted for the opportunity to see Jesus because he had heard about him and had been hoping for a long time to see him perform a miraculous sign. Okay? He wanted to see a show. He wanted to see a miracle. He wanted to see a sign, wonders. Well, he was like that. So we're going to use Herod to talk about us, to see if in some way, somehow, we are like Herod. We became like Herod. Okay? Because the question that we're going to consider is, why do so many people seek after signs and wonders? Because this movement is growing. Okay? It's just growing into the millions. We say that the Christian church is growing in Latin America, but mostly it's growing from this kind of a church where they are seeking after signs and wonders, where their main focus is miracles, and that's how they attract people, and that's how they invite, hey, you should come to my church. We have miracles there every time that we go. There are miracles there. And if you need a miracle, come. Oh, your baby is sick, come. We have miracles. And that's the invitation. And people are flocking to these churches. Those churches are growing. And many people are looking for signs and wonders. You might be saying, well, this message doesn't apply to me because I'm here in this church and that's not our emphasis. But keep an open mind because maybe there could be situations in your life when you suddenly switch and you are looking for signs and wonders because of your situation. And you forget about everything about sound doctrine. And we're going to find out what's the problem with that. Why? Why do I suddenly can switch from being a conservative in my doctrine and suddenly I switch into believing about all kinds of signs and wonders and all that, and because of my need, then I just change my doctrine? Why? I have seen it time and time and time again with people here in this church and other conservative churches in other parts, in Texas and all, and I have seen it. But why? Why do we do that? Okay? So, I'm not going to give you my opinion. Okay? I'm just going to give you five biblical reasons. Five biblical reasons. Okay? And if you have faith enough, I'm going to cover the five. Okay? All right? I'm going to cover the five. So let's get into them right now. Okay? First of all, you know, just to clarify the point, we believe what the Bible teaches, that our God is a God of miracles. Psalm 136, 4, it says, "Praise the Lord who alone does mighty miracles, for his loving kindness continues forever." Okay, so we're not saying that God already stopped doing miracles and that there are no miracles. No, because we have all experienced in some way or another that kind of supernatural intervention of God, probably in our lives, in the lives of a loved one or somebody that we know, a friend, a relative, a brother from the church, a sister from the church. But we know that God is a God of miracles. That's his nature. He's God. Okay, so we're not saying that God doesn't perform miracles. Okay, but what we're saying is not like other people view it. They see it like this is the norm, and that should be the norm, that God should be making miracles every time that the church gets together, there should be miracles and wonders and signs being performed, and that's what they expect. But that's not reality. And we have to understand why they believe in that manner. And one of the reasons, and the first one, is because some people seek after signs and wonders because of lack of knowledge. Nowadays, our churches, they're teaching only very superficial. It's like the news. That's the pattern of our society nowadays. You notice, you sit and watch the news, and they never touch that subject. There's a subject that they are discussing, and it's just briefly. Oh, no, we got to go on. But wait, this is very important. This debate is important for us to really get in depth. And they say, no, we're going to another thing. And now they change, and they change, and they change, and they change, and they change. Only talking points here. And sometimes the church becomes the same thing, just superficially, talking points. Oh yeah, miracles are in the Bible. Oh yeah, speaking in tongues is in the Bible. Oh, and we become talking points. But we don't really get into the Word of God and really study in depth. Why? Because, and this is one of the main reasons that I see, that everything is just superficial. And when you get in depth into a subject, say, oh no, that's legalism. I don't want that, that's too much. And so they came up with the idea that, you know, doctrine divides and love unites. So all you need is love. That's all we need, love. Okay? What about doctrine? What about what the Bible teaches? Okay? That's important. That's the foundation of faith. Okay? Sound doctrine is the foundation of real faith. So, what is it that the knowledge that they are lacking? Okay? I'm just going to give you briefly. Okay? Briefly. All right? They don't know the Bible, when we study the Bible, there are periods of miracles, okay? When you see all the span of time between Genesis and Revelation, it doesn't show that every day there are plenty of miracles going on in the story of the Bible. No. The Bible shows that there were periods where miracles were performed. Okay? Miracles were performed. But a period. So let me show you the first period. The first period the Bible presents is the period of Moses and Joshua. And later on, I'm going to tell you why those periods. Okay? But right now, let me just show you the periods. And if you don't have an outline, it's important for you to write and learn, because someday you're going to need that information to show it to somebody. Because why? Because they don't know. What I'm going to show you, they don't know this information. That's why they are seeking after signs and wonders, because they don't know. Okay? So at least you will have the information if you write it down in your outline. So Moses and Joshua, okay? That period lasted from the Exodus to about 1445 before Christ, through the career of Joshua that ended about in 1380 before Christ. Okay? Now, this period lasted 65 years. Okay? That period lasted 65 years only. All right? So keep that in mind. First period lasted 65 years, where God, the norm was the miracles through Moses and Joshua. That was the norm. And then, you know, what is the regular way of God dealing with us? Then for many, many, many years, you know, history continued, but not with all the miracles that were performed during this time. And always keep in mind that Moses and Joshua, for them to perform miracles, it was not at their own will, that they could perform miracles anytime they wanted. No. They were always under the leadership and the guidance of God. God would lead them and guide them to perform a miracle when God knew that that miracle was needed, okay, for his purposes. It's not that, oh, I have the power to make miracles, anyway, hey, yeah, boom, and you, boom, yeah. They were not like that. Like the way you see it nowadays, that supposedly, I have the power, so I'm gonna, everybody's gonna fall down. Everybody's gonna fall down because I have the power. That's not, you won't find Moses doing that to the nation of Israel, throwing them on the floor. So, 65 years, second period, Elijah and his student. Elijah was his student, his pupil, okay? And chronologically, they ministered from about 860 before Christ until 795 BC. So that tells us that the second period of miracles lasted how long? Another 65 years. So it's easy for you to remember. First period lasted 65 years. Second period lasted 65 years. Right? So now we come to period number three, and that's Christ and his apostles. Okay? Christ and his apostles in the New Testament. Okay? So he, obviously, it began with Jesus' ministry and lasted at the very longest until the death of the last apostle. The last apostle was John. So this period lasted how long? Another 65 years. Coincidence? Do you think it's coincidence? First 65, second 65, third 65. 65 years. Those three periods of miracles. Okay? Now, the purpose. Miracles introduce. This is very important for you to understand, because this is what they don't know. That's why they are seeking after miracles, because they don't really know. Introduce new eras of revelation. Okay? New eras of revelation. Because we know that God has revealed, you know, his purposes, you know, little by little. And he did it through eras. Okay? And let me show you. All three of those periods that we just went through of miracles were times when God gave his written revelation. Isn't that important, to give his written revelation? Okay, so in those three periods, that's when he gave his written revelation. For example, the first one, Moses and Joshua, the time of the giving of the law. The giving of the law. And we have that kind of division in the Bible. What are the books of the law? The books of the law. How many books we have, the books of the law? Five books of the law. Okay? So those are the five books that Moses wrote. Okay? So during that time, and we're going to learn why miracles, to introduce that period or era of new revelation. And then the second period with Elijah and Elisha, introduced the prophetic office. Okay? That's when the prophets started their ministry and the prophetic age. In all of the books of prophecy, major prophets and minor prophets. So right here you have the whole Old Testament. All the complete Old Testament. Right? So in order to give this important information, revelation that God was giving to Israel, okay, then miracles were performed. And we're going to learn why it was necessary, those miracles. Okay? Now, number three, the era number three, the New Testament. Okay? That's the era of Jesus and the apostles. The New Testament, obviously, Christ did miracles and apostles did miracles. That introduced the era of the New Testament revelation. So we have the whole Bible there, right? We have the whole Bible. And in those periods that the whole Bible was written, that God gave his revelation, miracles were performed for a purpose. Not just to go to church and see something spectacular. That was not the purpose. Nowadays, they're being used, those false miracles that are performing over there outside. They're using them just like fun. Come. Have fun. You're going to be surprised of what you see. Okay? So, we have to understand that it was the eras. So, listen, whenever God was going to pour out his word, he wanted to certify certain prophets and teachers of his word to authenticate them. That means that in order for these prophets, okay, in order for Moses, Joshua, and all the prophets, Jesus, and the apostles to have authority for people to see them and say, hey, they come from God. That's why God gave them the power to make miracles, so that they will have the authority. So when they would speak, when they would write, they would say, yes, I'm going to believe that person because God was with that person. We saw him open the Red Sea. We saw them even resurrect the dead. We saw them real illnesses, people that were born with situations that were not curable. They were able to cure them. Things like that. Not like nowadays, that psychosomatic illnesses. Oh, I have headaches. Oh, I have this. I'm healed. Look, now I can move. Not things like that. It was real. And it was huge what they were making. See? Ask somebody nowadays that thinks that I'm an apostle or I'm like Moses. Okay, let's go and open the sea. See if you can open the sea. See if you can resurrect a person. Okay? How come you cannot resurrect a person? Let's go to the hospital and clean it up. Let's clean it up and bring everybody outside and have a carne asada to celebrate. Okay? I'll pay for the carne asada. Nothing like that is possible. Okay? Because it had a purpose. Miracles had a real biblical purpose, and the purpose was to authenticate and give authority to those that God was giving his revelation. Okay? Moses, Joshua, all the prophets that we find in the Old Testament, Jesus, and all the apostles and the prophets that we find in the New Testament. Okay? You remember the problems that the Apostle Paul had with the Corinthians. Okay? The Corinthians was the more problematic church in the New Testament because they were the most carnal church. And they accused Paul that he was not a real apostle. Hey, you're not one of the original ones. Okay? You are a wannabe apostle, but you're not a real apostle. The real apostles are Peter, John, and James, and those are the real apostles. But you, they were always criticizing Paul that he was not a real apostle. And then he had to defend his apostleship. He had to defend, and he even told them when he wrote in 2 Corinthians, hey, I don't want to write like this. It sounds like if I'm, you know, saying, look at me, I'm a great apostle. But you're making me show off. And one of the verses, it says something that is important for us to understand. When he says, when I was with you, he's telling the Corinthians, I certainly gave you proof that I am a true apostle. For I patiently did many signs and wonders and miracles among you. You see? He's saying, you see, I'm a real apostle. I'm a true apostle. Look at my ID. My ID of being a true apostle is signs, wonders, and miracles. So it's not like nowadays they want to say that all Christians should be doing signs and wonders and miracles and great things. No, and think that in those days was like that, that all Christians had the power to do those signs and wonders and miracles. Then how would you recognize the apostles, the true apostles, if everybody was able to do signs and wonders and miracles? How would you recognize? Anybody could say, I'm also an apostle. Look, I can do miracles. I can heal. I can do this. I can raise the dead. If everybody was doing that, then everybody could claim to be an apostle, right? But no. Those were the sign gift. And that's why they're called sign. Because they pointed as a sign. They pointed to a person and say, this person is chosen by me to bring this new revelation, to establish something new now, like the church, in the case of the apostles, to establish the church. So that's why I gave them this power. Even the title apostle means one with the same authority and power from the person that commissioned him. So they were commissioned by Jesus. And if you read in the New Testament, it said Jesus called his 12 apostles and commissioned them and gave them power over unclean spirits, over all kinds of illnesses. But to them, he gave them, not to every believer that would come to knowledge and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ, they were going to be able to do those things. No, that's why the Apostle Paul was able to defend his apostleship and say, hey, you know I'm a true apostle because of all the miracles, wonders, and signs that I perform among you. Who else was able to do what I did? Nobody else. Why? Because nobody else is an apostle but me. But me. So you see, there was a purpose. It was not just to have spiritual fun. Oh, we're going to have spiritual fun and watching miracles and wonders and those things. Not like that. See, that's why, you see, because there were periods of those miracles. We see in the book of Hebrews, is one of the last books written, and by then, most of the apostles were already executed, okay? By the time that was written Hebrews, they considered that maybe it was only John and the other Judas and maybe another apostle. Maybe only three apostles were still ministering, okay? At the time when they wrote the book of Hebrews. That's why we don't even know who was the real writer of the book of Hebrews, but it's an inspired book. Some say it was written by Paul, but most likely Paul was already executed by then. But look at the way the writer is presenting the gospel and the things that happened when the gospel was first presented. He says in Hebrews 2:3-4, he says in 3. So what makes us think we can escape if we ignore this great salvation that was first announced by the Lord Jesus himself and then delivered to us by those who heard him speak? Okay, so he's telling those Hebrews that were on the sideline, that they were hesitant about giving their lives to Christ or remain in their Judaism, and but I like what I see and what I hear here, but no commitment. So he's telling them, hey, what make you think that you're that nothing's going to happen to you just by remain in that position, just doubting and not really making a commitment to follow Jesus? And then look what he says in the next verse. Verse 4, he says, and God confirmed the message by giving signs and wonders and various miracles and gift of the Holy Spirit whenever he chose. Whenever God chose. Not whenever they wanted. Not whenever the apostles wanted. Okay? Everything was under God's will. Okay? Under God's will. Not under their own will. But now he's speaking in past tense. And God confirmed. You see? It's in past tense. The writer, he's writing like in the year 69 after Christ, and he's already mentioning all the miracles that were performed by the apostles and everything that happened in Pentecost. He's speaking about that in past tense. Okay? Like, okay, that happened. It had a purpose, okay, to confirm the message and the messengers with great miracles and wonders. Now they were confirmed. So the sign ceases to have a purpose. Okay? So that's why we believe that those miraculous signs and wonders and miracles, that kind of spiritual gift given to the apostles, were only temporary to that season of time. Okay? And then most of the apostles were already dead, so they were not performing miracles, and not even, if you know, even Paul, he even resurrected people, Paul, but he couldn't heal himself. He couldn't heal himself, and he was ill, and he even asked the Lord, Lord, heal me, please. The Lord said, nope. And he said, maybe he didn't understand. Lord, look, you gave me this commission, and I'm going to all the Gentiles, nations, to take your gospel, but I'm having problems with my health. Heal me. And the Lord said, nope. So the third time, Paul said, Lord, I'm telling you, I need you to heal me. And the Lord said, no, I already told you no. Why? Because my power, you're going to experience my power. What you need is my power. And my power is going to become real in your life when you depend on me. And because I know you, Paul, I know you very well, even I know you better than you know yourself, you're going to need this in order for you to be humble and to depend on me, on my power, instead on you depend on all your knowledge and all your studies and all your resources and all your smartness. No, I want you to depend on my wisdom and on my power. And this is what's going to take for you to have this. So you see, they were not in control of those miracles and wonders. Like nowadays, they present it like, oh yeah, they're in control. Let's just put a tent outside and I have the power to do any kind of miracle that I want, to anyone that I want. And it's not biblical. So, you see, that's the first thing. That's the first thing that I think is what the majority are experiencing. Why they seek signs and wonders? Because of lack of knowledge. They don't know these basic truths. Because look, I'm just teaching you the basics about this. And they don't know even the basics about the purpose of signs and wonders and miracles in the Bible, the Old and the New Testament. They don't know that. Now you know superficially, now you know. Okay. Now, secondly, another reason. Let's look at the second. Some people seek after signs and wonders because they want confirmation of the truth of God. Okay? So that means that their faith is weak. Their faith is weak. So, you know, I need evidence from God. Okay? I need evidence from God. I need God to do a miracle in order for me to truly believe. Okay? Truly believe. And we know that according to what the Bible teaches, it is better in God's sight to believe without needing to see a miracle. Okay? Remember the words of Jesus? I'm showing them in John 4:48 in the Amplify. It says, "Then Jesus said to him, 'Unless you people,'" and he is addressing in general the Jewish nation, "'see miraculous signs and wonders, you simply will not believe.'" And that's the reason why many people, they seek after signs and wonders and miracles in order to believe. In order to believe. I need to see in order to believe. I need a manifestation of God. That's why, you see, those that are already attending that kind of churches that supposedly they're experiencing miracles and miracles and miracles, you take them to another church like this and they say, "Oh, this is so boring. Wow. I can fall asleep here. Easy. This is boring." Because it is like entertainment. It is like entertainment for them. Okay? And they need that to believe. The Word of God is not enough to believe. It's not enough, the Word of God. They have to see something. They have to experience something supernatural in order to believe. And Jesus is telling us here, no. Let me show you another verse, John 4:41. It says, "Many more believe in him with a deep abiding trust because of his word," his personal message to them. You see the difference? The Samaritans, this passage is in reference to the Samaritan woman. Remember the Samaritan woman? She was transformed, she was changed, and she went and gave testimony to the people, and then some of them believed, and then they came, and then Jesus began to share the gospel, to share, to answer their questions and everything. And the Bible says that many believed because of his word. He didn't perform any miracle in Samaria. He did not perform any miracle. And they believe. It says here, many more believe in him with a deep, abiding trust, you know, real salvation, because of his word, his personal message to them, not because of signs and wonders and miracles, because of his word. Because of his teaching, that's how they believe. And that's real faith. The Bible says faith comes by hearing, and what we hear is the Word of God. The Word of God. That's real faith. That's supernatural faith. But if you need a miracle, an evidence, a supernatural evidence in order for you to believe, then your faith is weak and maybe you don't even have faith. You don't have faith. So that's what I was telling you. Us, when we are in a situation where we are in a great need, like, you know, like I have heard. Just lately somebody called me, Pastor, what do you think? This relative is going to have in their church a healing service. So they're inviting us to go because they had a person with an illness. And they are inviting us so that the ill person can be healed. What do you think, Pastor? Are you really asking me that question? You don't know what you're supposed to do in that situation? But, you know, it can happen because we are so desirous to see a loved one being healed or delivered or something that, you know, we forget about doctrine, and I can even go with a brujo, with a witch doctor. Somebody told me, look, my son was exactly like yours, and I took him to this witch doctor. I'm not going to say a witch doctor, but it's a witch. A witch doctor. Where? Let's go. Okay. And we tend to do things like that in desperation. Okay. Why? Because our faith is weak, lacking. So we have to understand that when we go through things like that, you know, it's a test of faith. Okay. God wants to see exactly where our faith is. You know, for our benefit, God knows exactly. That's why he's allowing that test, so that we can see the reality of our faith. Okay? The reality of our faith. So, this is what happened, that people want confirmation. Okay? Confirmation. And notice this other verse where Jesus says, then Jesus told him, you believe because you see me. Those who believe without seeing me will be truly blessed. Okay? This is when Thomas, when they told him, hey, he truly resurrected. We saw him. He appeared to us. He's alive. Oh, come on. No, I won't believe you guys until I see him. If I don't see him, I won't believe. And then Jesus appeared. Boom! Look, touch me. Touch me, Thomas. Oh, so he believed. Now he believed. And Jesus told him, hey, you believe because you see me? Those who believe without seeing me will be truly blessed. Will be truly blessed. When you were saved, were you able to see Jesus? Did you see Jesus? No, you believed by faith. Not by, you didn't say, well, I'm not going to believe that Jesus is for reals until he appears to me. You claim that he appeared to many in the Bible. Why not to me? Why not to me? Well, this verse is for you. Okay? It's just for you. All right, so this is the second, okay? Now, number three, some people seek after signs and wonders because they are curious, thrill seekers, okay? Thrill seekers. And you know, they are like the crowds in John 6:2 and like King Herod. You know, we just read that passage of King Herod in Luke 23:8. They want to see something sensational. But they have no real desire to know the truth of Christ. And those churches are full of people that they don't have any desire to really know the truth from God, the Word of God, what's real salvation. They're not interested in that. They're interested in emotions, feelings, experiences. That's all they want. That's all that is satisfying to them. Oh, it was great. It was great, they say. Heaven came down on us. Woo! Powerful. That's all. But no word, no truth, no reality from the real God, the real Bible. Nothing of that. Superficial, everything. Yes, the Bible was read and supposedly was preached. But in a distorted way just to continue with the same thing of emphasizing emotions and you know, one of the reasons, did you know that it's easier to take your money when you are in a highly emotional state than when you are on a thinking state? And here, in this church and other conservative churches, we try to keep you on a thinking level. Even though we know that it's not going to produce great income to the church. But we want the truth. We want to show you the truth from the Bible. Because if my goal was to take as much as money possible from you, then I would get you all excited with signs and wonders and emotions and demon-possessed people. I can ask my son to pretend that he's demon-possessed and it wouldn't be very difficult for him to act it out. Kidding, Aaron. But you see, that's what happens in those churches. Many, it's just a show. It's just a show. And when they ask him, but why do you do that? You know that it's not real. What is? It's because we want to stimulate the faith of non-believers. With a lie? You stimulate faith with the truth from the Word of God. That's the way you stimulate faith. Faith comes by hearing the Word of God, not by putting up a show that is not real, supposedly that you are healing somebody, or supposedly that you are delivering somebody from demons and all that, when it's not true. And that's the way you want to bring faith in the lives of non-believers? Mm-mm. And you know, there are many that are going to be thrill seekers that say, yeah, I want to go, it's fun. Okay? It says, a large crowd was following him. See, why? Why they were following him? The Bible tells us here why they were following Jesus. It says, because they had seen the signs, the attesting miracles, okay? Which he continually to perform on those who were sick. You know, as Jesus was going, he was doing miracles, healing people and all that, and they were just following because of that. They were even saying, hey, bring people, bring sick and demon-possessed. We want to see the show is good. We want to see that. Thrill seekers. And you will find that many that go to those churches, or they are seeking for a thrill, okay, for an emotion. They want that kind of emotions. Did you know that kind of emotions are addictive? You know, that's one of the reasons why many members of those churches, they are changing from church to church. They are constantly changing from church to church because, you know, the show there now is not giving them the rush, the emotion that at the beginning was giving them. So now they hear that, this church, the gates of heaven are open in this church. I'm going to go to that church and experience new things and feel new things. And so now they change, and then it becomes old, and now they look for another church where new experiences are going on. That's why if you even look in YouTube, they even have nowadays services of barking like dogs, supposedly led by the Holy Spirit, or laughter. 45 minutes, everybody laughing, and then they come out of the service and say, ooh, that was great. Ooh, the Holy Spirit manifested in a powerful way among us. We couldn't stop laughing. And the only thing that comes to my mind are the days when I was smoking weed. That was my experience. But not the Holy Spirit. That's not. All right. Okay. So it says, This is our passage. Herod was delighted at the opportunity to see Jesus because he had heard about him. About him? About what? About the gospel? About the good news? No. He had heard about him, and he was hoping for a long time to see him perform a miraculous sign. All he had in mind is, I have heard that he's a magician. He can do great things. He wonderful and miracles, and so I want to see one. I want to see him. So I'm glad that he's coming because I'm going to ask him to entertain me here. Thrill seekers, they wanted that. Okay, and you know many people go like that. Number four, and we only have 4 minutes. Some people seek after signs and wonders because they do not believe the signs and wonders which have already been performed. They don't believe the Bible. They don't believe that the miracles that the Bible presents were real. They say, oh, do you really think that Moses opened the Red Sea? Oh, come on. You got to be kidding. You don't really believe that. I already saw National Geographic, and they explain it scientifically. That this is impossible and nobody can do that. That what happened really is this and that. And they come up with another alternative that is not a miracle. They just passed through a side of the Red Sea where the water just was up to this level. Okay? You say, no, it's because, but they say, and they give you all kinds. And somebody said, well, so now that was a greater miracle. But they don't believe. And the Pharisees of Matthew 12 were just such kind of people. Okay? The Pharisees of Matthew 12. Jesus had been performing miracles for quite some time when a group of scribes and Pharisees came to him with an insolent demand. Okay? They have heard only that Jesus was performing miracles, and they would say, "Now, come on, people, they are ignorant. There's no such thing. They're ignorant." Okay, and if you know, that was the difference between a Pharisee and a Sadducee or a scribe. That the Pharisees they believe in miracles up to a certain point, but the Sadducees they didn't believe in miracles. Okay. They didn't believe in miracles. They didn't even believe in angels. Okay, so that's why they were always arguing among themselves. Okay, but some of the Pharisees were more leaning towards the Sadducee side, the liberal side, and really doubting the existence of real miracles and not just make-believe miracles. Okay, and there he says, one day some teachers of religious law and Pharisees came to Jesus and said, "Teacher, we want you to show us a miraculous sign to prove your authority. To prove your authority. Okay? Show us a miraculous sign." They didn't believe all the miracles that he had already performed. They didn't believe. And nowadays is the same thing. Same thing. There are many that don't believe that. And then Jesus told them, look, but Jesus replied, "Only an evil, adulterous generation would demand a miraculous sign. But the only sign I will give them is the sign of the prophet Jonah." So you see, when we are seeking after signs and wonders and miracles, Jesus is telling us, hey, that's evil. That's an adulterous mentality. Spirituality, that's not right for you to be seeking after that. That's lack of faith. You're really not trusting in me. Okay? And then look what he told them. "The only sign I will give them is the sign of the prophet Jonah." You know what the sign of the prophet Jonah was? What? His resurrection. His resurrection. Did they believe with that sign? That when he resurrected, did they believe? They didn't even believe even with that sign. Because he resurrected. And they were trying to make the soldiers, you have to say this, that the disciples came at night and they stole the body. Okay? And we're going to give you some money, but you say that. Okay? Because they knew that he resurrected, but they didn't want to believe the sign, not even that sign, that miracle. Okay? So, that's another reason. The last one. Oh, no. Okay, let me show you modern people that they don't believe in miracles, like Benedict Spinoza. He's well known. He was a Dutch philosopher who laid the groundwork for the 18th century Enlightenment and modern biblical criticism. He came to be considered one of the great rationalists of the 17th century philosophy. Okay, in with philosophy, as a rationalist, he began to prove that there's no miracles in the Bible. Okay, you have to understand the people in those days, okay, what they truly believed and their level of education and their lack of really knowledge of science like the one that we have nowadays, that we can explain everything in a more rational way, scientifically way. So that he is the one that began that modern biblical criticism that is very strong with German theologians. Okay, and David Hume also, okay, was a Scottish philosopher, historian, economist, and atheist, who is best known today for his highly influential system of radical philosophical empiricism, skepticism, and naturalism. With skepticism, you know, this school of philosophy teach that, don't believe. That your first reaction is, don't believe. Be a skeptic. Say, no, I don't believe that. I don't believe that. Until it can be proven scientifically, okay? But your first reaction has to be a skeptic. Don't believe, don't believe, don't believe, and don't believe, okay? So we have our modern people. And lastly, some people seek after signs and wonders because they hope to get something for themselves, okay? Oh, I'm gonna go because I'm gonna get rich, or I'm gonna get wealth and health. Jesus replied, "The truth of the matter is that you seek me because I fed you, not because you believe in me." Okay. So many were following Jesus because what they were getting out of Jesus. Okay. And many people say, "Well, yeah, I'm gonna go to those churches. I'm gonna follow Jesus because then I'm gonna be in good health, and I'm going to be wealthy." Okay, and we even have the example of Simon the sorcerer. Remember, he wanted to buy the power of God when he saw Peter doing signs and wonders and miracles. He told him, "How much do you want? But give me that power. I want to have that power. Give me that power." Okay, so it happened. People, they say, "Oh yeah, if I go to that church and I belong to that church, then I'm going to be able to do miracles and I'm going to be able to speak in angelic languages and do such a weird things by the power of the Holy Spirit." And so they're following because they want something for them. They want to get something for them, or get healed, health and wealth. That is the attraction of the modern health and wealth gospel movement. That's how the majority of these churches are called, the health and wealth gospel movement. And it is very attractive. They tell you, "Hey, God wants you wealthy and healthy. Come on, come to our church, and that's what you are going to experience. You're going to experience wealth and health, because here we have the power to heal, and we have the power with faith words to create your wealth. So come over and you will learn and you will experience that. Isn't that attractive? Am I convincing you? Am I going to be by myself next week here? Okay. So, better than seeking after a new miracle is taking God at His word. And that's what I want you to be established in the Word of God. Okay? I don't want you to fall for emotions, for impressions, for experiences, for supernatural things, because not all supernatural experiences are from God. You have to understand that. The Bible says that the deceiver is even deceiving people with signs and wonders. Deceptive. So be careful. Okay? Let's pray. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for this opportunity to see the life of us as we consider the reasons for seeking signs, wonders, and miracles. Lord, lead us to really evaluate our faith. Is our faith strong enough to confront whatever trial and suffering we might encounter in this life, trusting only in your word, in your promises, in sound doctrine? Or we're going to need supernatural evidence. We're going to need signs and wonders to believe in you. We thank you, Lord, for your word. Your word is truth. Your word is everything that we need. In your word, we find everything for a life of righteousness and peace. Lead us and guide us, Lord, for we ask you in Jesus' name and for His glory. Amen.